Okay, so today we're going to discuss a product made this summer on the role of cyclones in the NARCCAP model suite.
Okay, so how we track a storm, what I've done with the NARCCAP model suite. I'm going to show an assessment of the ensemble mean storm track frequency and intensity climatologies. That's kind of a neat feature of this research. Past research I've done, I've never been able to look at so many different model simulations. So it's a lot of work, but at the same time, it's really great because I'm able to finally do ensemble means of my diagnostics. I'm also going to compare ensemble mean seasonal rainfall from storms with total rainfall. So the question is there a good linkage with the rainfall with the storm tracks? I'll show you how I did that. And I'll show you an evaluation. So I did also, in a lot of the software I developed, I created a Midwestern index, which I'll show you, to evaluate rainfall. So we're going to be looking at Midwestern index both for A2, which is the global warming scenario, and historical, which is the mean climate. And I'll show you a picture of what that looks like in a second, too. And also, the other neat thing is, of the 20 simulations I've been looking at, 4 of them are NSEP-driven models. So those run from 1979 to 2004 total. And so the neat thing about that is I can actually look at teleconnections. So in addition to looking at global warming impacts with the NSEP models, and I think this also is good for agricultural interests, we also can look at teleconnections, for example, such as NSEP. I'll show you one slide of just where I kind of tapped into that briefly. So first question is, how do we track a storm? So really, it's a very basic program. You're looking at gridded data, and we're looking at the lowest field pressure point relative to surrounding grid boxes. And the data I'm looking at is 3-hourly data, and each of the runs, which I'll show you in a second, are 3-hourly for 33 years. So here you see, time step 1, that red spot will be a storm, and 3 hours later, the storm moves to the left, let's say, off diagonally to the right. Time step 3, diagonally further to the right, connect the dots, and that's a storm track. So here's an example of what the output would look like. So this is from reanalysis data. This is one of the first results. This is going back to my 2006 paper. So this is showing NSEP reanalysis 1 storm track. This is for January through March of 1983. And what you see here are all the different storm tracks. So different colors are different intensities that you see in the bottom. So where you see the purple lines and the dashed lines, those are the storms of deeper intensity. And this is kind of where, you know, I got really interested in this project, where this just shows really the weather-climate connection, where, you know, one can look at a storm track as a meteorologist, but as a climatologist, you can look at the whole suite of storm tracks. So I boxed over 2 of the main storm tracks where you see the storms going time and time again, one over the North Pacific and one from the Gulf of Mexico to off the East Coast. And actually, this Gulf of Mexico track is specific to the year 1983 because that was a strong El Nino year. And so what do you do with this data then? So how do you create climatologies? So let me use reanalysis as an example. The original reanalysis 1 data set went from 1950 to about 2000. So all you do is, let's say you take a season, and I created 5x5 boxes. And 5x5 is an appropriate size for capturing the storm. I found that if you go too small with the box, the tracks become very muted in the climatology. It gets kind of this noisiness to it. The box is too large, it gets kind of smeared out. So 5x5 now is an appropriate box size. All you do is you count a storm that goes over a box. Let's say I drew a box there, storm crosses it, I just count it, and then I just divide by the number of years to obtain the climatology. Another piece of data I had also with this is intensity. So I also did the same thing. I get also an average intensity of storms. So here's what that would look like, and this is just from the reanalysis data set. So this is from reanalysis 1. This is the average from January to March. And so on the top, you're seeing storm frequency. I boxed over the active North Pacific track, active North Atlantic track. You can also see a track coming from the Lee Rockies up toward the Great Lakes here. On the bottom is the intensity. So notice the intensity, the scale goes from minus 24 to 0. So those are in hectopascals. And the way I obtain this is I take the storm track intensity, I subtract out a regressed mean intensity climatology. And you want to do this because if you just went with the absolute field pressure, let's say if you had 980 hectopascal low off of Cape Hatteras, North Carolina down here, it would not be the same intensity as a 980 low up in the Aleutians or the Icelandic area, for example, because those areas already have an inherently lower pressure. So a better representation is just track out a main climatology. Now I'll show you this also for the NARCCAP data. So NARCCAP, so what simulations am I looking at? I'm going to constantly refer to A1, or the A2, and century, which I call historical. So this is showing the greenhouse surface warming, and you're seeing here the two data sets I'm looking at for the 20th century or historical. It goes from 1968 to 2000, and you see there's already a bit of a trend in warming over that 33-year period. And then the second period is the A2 period. This runs from 2030 to 2070, and that would be this red line right that goes like this. So we're capturing this part of that scenario, those 33 years from 2038 to 2070. And once again, we're going to evaluate all of our diagnostics, all the storm track, precipitation, and all the way down the line between this 20th century and this A2. So what's the progress that's been done so far? So the first part was quite frankly creating all the data sets. So I've created storm frequency, intensity, precipitation, and storm layer precipitation, which I'll go into in a bit, from all the simulations below. So what the NARCCAP is, the NARCCAP are a bunch of GCMs, which are indicated in parentheses here, like GFDL, the Hadley model, the CCSM model, and the GCM provides the boundary conditions for the mesoscale models. So this is a unique data set because what you're looking at here is high resolution mesoscale data on a climatological basis. And it gives you a really great opportunity to look at more structure than you would, for example, from a 2x2 lat 1 reanalysis. So I have 20 simulations. I have eight historical or 20th century, which I said run from 68 to 2000, eight A2 from 2038 to 2070. And as I go through this, I'll be referring to ensemble means, and that refers to an average of the eight historical and the eight A2. And for NSEP models, I run from 79 to 04. Those are all the simulations down here. And the data I've used is 3 hour length of 33 years, and triple to a 1/2 by 1/2 degree lat long grid. And to my relief, by the way, this summer I've been able to purchase more equipment because I needed a lot more disk space because as I go through this, these 3 hour data sets really build up quickly, as you might imagine. So here's one issue I had. So this is kind of interesting. So when I first started looking at the frequency of climatologies, like I said, the way you calculate frequency of climatology is you just take a storm that crosses a 5x5 area and count it and keep counting. And what I've done in the past, in my past experience, is that in the desert southwest, you get this big maximum due to heat loads. And the way I filter those out is I make a storm has to be that 5-degree grid box in order to be counted. Well, in this case, even though I had that first filter in, you can see on the left, so this is winter, January to March, April to June, July, September, October, November. This is storm track frequency climatology. And you see this big maximum over the Rocky Mountains, so upwards of 20 storms per season, or even more, and persistent through all seasons. And if you look at the literature, you look at the stuff I've done, so for example, I'll go back into my reanalysis plot. Now, count the number of storms in the Rockies here. You're talking about 7 or 8 storms. And the literature, that's about right, give or take a storm. So this is far above what I expected. And so I started to test the program and see if I could get rid of this. And so what I did was, in the area of the Rockies, going, let's say, from New Mexico, Arizona, all the way up into southwestern Canada, what I did was I only counted the storm that jumps 2 boxes ahead. In other words, it's got to move 10 degrees. It's got to move away from the mountains to be counted and be transitory. And on the right, you see the results of that. So what's nice about this, you see that big bullseye is gone. And by the way, when I did, I'm not showing this, but I did look at the intensity of those storms in that Rocky Mountain bullseye area. And they're all very, very weak storms. So this is maybe something from the mild topography, I'm not sure, but something that doesn't agree well with literature. When I put that filter in, you can see that those maximums are gone. You get a much more realistic looking storm track. It doesn't take away from other storms, so it's not like I'm taking away storms that come out of the Rockies and move across the lakes or the East Coast. You see the rest of the structure is in place. So once again, looking at the filtered storms, which is what I'll be referring to for the rest of this talk, you can see winter, spring, summer, fall. You see a nice East Coast track that tends to shift north over time, and then back to the south in the fall. You see a storm track in the lee of the Rockies, and also something across southwestern Canada and into the Pacific Northwest. And so here's the ensemble mean frequencies then. So this was for, let's see, Okay, so this is for sum over mean frequency. So now I'm taking all the models and averaging them together. This is just one example of a model. This is, I think it's the GFDL HRM3. This is the average of all the models. And some interesting features here. So on the left is historical. On the right is A2. And what you see is, let's focus on the East Coast first. So the East Coast track starts off of the Carolinas up to off of Maine, goes northward with time as it should, heads back to the south. You see a nice Rocky Mountain track. In fact, it seems almost too robust. And an oddity here, this is something which I haven't really assessed yet. You start to see this downward protuberance off of California, which looks okay for the winter, but it maintains so for the summer. So I'm not sure, you know, which models are doing this. I'll have to look at this member by member, but I don't think you get a lot of storms off California in the summer. So this is, I don't think this is realistic at all. And then if you look at the A2 run, you get basically the same kind of pattern. The one thing I found kind of strange, too, I mean, it's a lot of things right, but looking at the summertime, my gosh, it gets too many storms across much of the U.S. And what's interesting about this is what I'll show you the intensity. This must be very weak storms because I don't get an increase in intensity over this area, nor do I get an increase in rainfall in this area either. So this is something that maybe the models are doing, and I'm not sure, but once again, that's kind of an interesting feature, and I'll leave it at that for now. Here's the ensemble mean intensity. So once again, this is subtracting out a regressed seasonal climatology. And you can see that Atlantic low well represented in the wintertime. This is historical on the left again, A2 on the right by season. And this shows a nice seasonal progression from intense Icelandic low in the wintertime, weakening to the summer, intensifying back to the fall. For A2, about the same thing. Once again, intense Icelandic low, weakening and coming back. And also you can see a hint of North Pacific activity off the West Coast. And of course, because the model domain doesn't extend out past about 150 degrees west, you know, I can't see what's beyond here. And if you look at the reanalysis data, you'll see a much more active storm track in the North Pacific, but I always catch an edge of that because that's where the model domain is. So looking at the differences then, so what I did was I looked at the A2 minus the historical differences, and I applied a two-tailed t-test 90% significance. And so on the left is the frequency difference, A2 minus historical. Once again, looking at the ensemble mean. On the right is the intensity difference. So once again, what you're seeing is in the global warming run, there's really excess of storms off the West Coast. I'm wondering if this has to do with maybe the fact that waters are warming off the West Coast in the A2 run, something that we have to explore, but something that's unexpected. You also see a lot more storms across the eastern half of the U.S. in the summertime. That's significant. But if you look to the right, you know, look at the intensity, this orange color indicates weaker storms in the CO2 run. So it's kind of dichotomous of what's going on. One nice feature here, which I really like, and this is something that's seen in the literature quite a bit, is sort of this dual structure in the cold half of the season. So you see a decrease in storm frequency across the northern tier of the U.S., an increase across central and northern Canada, and this would suggest a northward shift of the storm track in a warming scenario. You see this both in the winter and in the fall. For intensity, I didn't really see a lot of significant differences between the two runs. A bit of a hint of a stronger Icelandic low in the A2 simulation ensemble. But in the fall, you get this big area of increased intensity across Canada. Once again, it's something we'll have to explore, and that's kind of an interesting result as well. So another thing I wanted to look at, too, this is another way of showing where the storm tracks are. I looked at the storm frequency, and I did a variance study on it. So I looked at, by grid box, I calculated the variance. So once again, by season, for the ensemble mean, and you can see the main storm areas across the historical run, across the Aleutian areas, across just the across in the North Pacific, that weird area off the West Coast, looks like a Lee Rocky area and East Coast. And you see this through the other seasons as well, with this, once again, it's kind of blow up across the Rockies in the summertime. For the A2 run, I see a similar structure, although it seems more variability across southern Alaska and western Canada and just off the shore in the A2 run. And you do see a Lee Rocky track, East Coast track, once again, represented in all the seasons, and a weakening of the East Coast track in the summertime in the A2. But you do see its increased variability, which may have to do with the increased frequency across the Gulf Coast. possibility too, this could be tropical in nature. I'll show you a little suggestion of that, although that was for the fall. I'll show you that also in a second. Let me see if it's here. Actually, it's right here. Let me show you this. So another little feature, too, which was really interesting. With the storm tracks, there's no law that says that I can't get tropical systems. I don't differentiate middle latitude from tropical. I'm just looking at lowest pressure. So if you look at A2 minus, historically, you see an increase in storms across the Western Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico, an increase in intensity down across the Western Caribbean. This may suggest something tropical. And also across the Pacific, too, you're seeing this increase in intensity in A2 relative to historical off of Mexico. Once again, suggesting more tropical development in the A2 relative to the historical. So one thing, now we'll get down to the rainfall. So what we started with here, we started with this general diagnosis of what the storms look like. And the way I'm heading with this is I'm tunneling down to what I would consider results relevant to the Midwest, which is, of course, what the grant's all about. So one thing I calculated was storm-related rainfall. And the way I do that is now these big rectangles here, these are composed of one-half-degree boxes. That's too noisy for me to put that in, but imagine all the still half-degree boxes. I put a low center right about here. So it's a 9-degree width longitude by 13-degree latitude down across the center here for a box. And I center the low on the northern part of the box because storms are asymmetrical. A lot of the rainfall is often associated with funnel systems. Now, I've done this before. I did this for my 2006 paper with pretty good results. And I tried other size boxes, but the 9 by 13 seems to work pretty well. And what I do is I calculate the rainfall around the storm system. It says the storm moves here, calculate the rainfall again, calculate the rainfall again. So in this way, I'm looking at both two things here. One, the total rainfall from the models, and then second, storm-related rainfall from carrying the rainfall around each storm. So here's what this looks like. So on the left, what you're seeing on the left is in the colors, this is total rainfall in millimeters for each season. And so you're looking at winter, spring, summer, and fall again. The contours of the storms. So what I thought I'd show here is how the storms and rainfall are co-located. So you see on the left, on the contours, you can see the east coast storm track. You kind of see the maximum rainfall on the edges of the model domain to the east. And for the spring, kind of hard to see. You don't really see much cohesion here. You're seeing a main storm track up across the U.S.-Canadian border and a maximum rainfall off to the south a bit. And for the summertime, especially displaced to the south. And then for the fall, okay, fairly well co-located. You also can see the Pacific storm track, so the Western Canada storm track, co-located fairly well to precipitation. When I do the storm-related rainfall, on the right, you can see that the rainfall gets pulled in much more tightly to the storms, to the storm maximums. So here you see the storm maximum with the rainfall right below it. Pacific track, once again, pretty well aligned for the spring. Not too bad for the summer, although once again, for the summer, you expect less of the rainfall to be due to storms and more due to convective processes. So I think both will contribute. And once again, for the fall, pretty well co-located. And so that was for the historical anomaly. This is for A2. Very similar result again. I'm not going to go into detail, but the results are, in fact, they were so identical, I actually went back to make sure I didn't duplicate my efforts, but no, I did it correctly. And the results are, they're not the same, but they're pretty similar. So A2 gets the same kind of structure with the storms and with the co-located rainfall below it. Oh, and this, what this shows, what I thought I'd also do is a question you can ask is, how much of the rainfall is due to storms from my method versus the total rainfall? So I just took the storm-related rainfall and divided by the total rainfall. And once again, this is for the historical on the left, A2 on the right. And you see a maximum on the East Coast in the wintertime, about 30 to 35% of the rainfall is due to cyclones, about 25% across the Midwest. You see, as we get toward the summertime, looking at the Midwest, it drops to about 20% as the main storm track shifts to the north. This is a really nice way of showing this. On the right, you're seeing this for the A2 run. Once again, very similar structure. Not much difference between historical and A2 in this case. So greater than 30% rainfall budget off the East Coast, about 25% across the Midwest, dropping to about 20%, although a little higher, I think, in the A2 run in the summertime. Once again, increasing in the fall. Now, looking at some mean rainfall differences, let's do the rainfall differences of A2 minus historical. On the left is storm rainfall. On the right is total rainfall. And the colors indicate departure from the differences in terms of millimeters between the A2 and the historical. So what you're seeing is in the A2 runs, the red indicates increased rainfall in A2. So you're seeing in winter you get increased rainfall across the southern U.S. up the East Coast. In the fall, in the spring rather, it decreased off the East Coast. Still pretty good increase across the Great Lakes. And then in the summer, not much signal from the storms themselves, a little suggestion of decrease just to our west, across Kansas, Colorado, then increase back in the fall. However, what I found most interesting about this is looking at the total rainfall. So looking at the total rainfall, you see that in the winter, an increase across the Midwest, but you're seeing drying across Texas and the Southwest. Notice what happens as you proceed to spring. That dryness spreads across the Rockies and the Gulf of Mexico. By summer, that dryness is right over the Midwest. That's something I want to explore more carefully. So this will come down to the question of, are there more droughts in the A2 runs? And also, you know, even looking at, you know, this main storm track is up here, there still might be some causation in terms of, as the storms pass to the north, it may cause an increase in the low-level jet for extreme rainfall events, even though you're drier. So something definitely to look at. And I do say, you know, despite the dryness, you might get more rainfall in terms of extreme events. And this is due to an index I'll show you in a second, which shows some really interesting results, especially toward the end of the run. So more progress. I created storm frequency intensity indices. I haven't looked at these yet in terms of analysis, but they're available and they're all available for each simulation. So I look at a Great Lakes Midwest storm area, area along the East Coast, and area further out. Off the Maritimes. That's to sort of get the real, you know, more of the Icelandic area. For rainfall indices, I looked at these four areas. So these are all developed. Once again, three for the East Coast. Forget my bias, but I'm going to look at East Coast storms too, so I put that in there. And one, this is for the Midwestern section that I'm going to show in a second. So what I did was I computed rainfall in this box. So I computed every little grid box. Once again, rainfall is 1/2 degree. I summed all the rainfall in here and saved it for each season for every year. And I'll show you that in a second. So when looking at the rainfall, so let's look at that Midwestern index. So on the top left is the historical for all rainfall. On the right is A2 for all rainfall. Bottom left, historical for the storm-related rainfall. Bottom right, A2 storm-related rainfall. So on the top left, what you're looking at is, look at this green line. This is showing two standard deviations. This line right here is one standard deviation above. Yellow line, one standard deviation below. Orange line, two standard deviations below. And also, I calculated regression, so I drew a regression line through the plot. And so what you're seeing in terms of the all precipitation one is a tendency toward drying or lowering precipitation. And remember, too, let's go back up here for a second. So the historical run is not stationary, but there is some warming associated with it. So you are seeing some drying in that. But just to muddle things further, let me go down into this again. Notice for the A2 scenario, once again, 2038 to 2070, you're seeing, once again, here are the standard deviation, 2, 1, minus 1, minus 2. You're seeing an increased rainfall trend in this one. So the question will be, and I'll show this in the next slide, is, you know, well, it's decreasing here and the climate is warming a bit, but increasing in EA2. Yet, you know, overall, this whole graph is a little less than this whole graph as far as the absolute amount. And I'll show you in a second, I'm going to superimpose these two plots and kind of show you what they're doing over time. And for the storm-related rainfall, you're seeing a similar pattern. So, once again, decrease in rainfall. Notice also the nice cohesion of the points in here. So, the maximums of total rainfall are associated very well with the historical storm-related rainfall. And by the way, this is for the summer of July to September. And for the A2, once again, you get these peaks co-located pretty well together between the all rainfall and the storm rainfall. So the storm rainfall is less because it's not, you know, a lot of rainfall through other processes. But yet you still see that drying trend in the historical and a bit of a wet trend in the A2. So to compare then the A2 to the historical and just put those together, where they look like. This to me is like one of the most interesting plots, and this is the very last plot I produced last night for this. This is something I definitely want to explore further. So on the left listen, this is looking at all rainfall. The green would be the, let's see, that is the historical. The orange line is the A2. And what you're seeing is that in the beginning, looking at the beginning of the runs, you notice the A2 is drier than historical. So historical is dry as a drying trend. But look what happens in the A2, and this is something really worth exploring. Notice that as you go further out, in the beginning, almost every year, the A2 is drier in the Midwest in summertime than the historical. As I get toward the end of the run, remember, the end of the run with the A2 is the time when the CO2 is maximized and the temperature impact is maximized. Suddenly, the A2 is winning out. It's really producing more rainfall than the historical run. Storm rainfall, a little noisier, but basically the same pattern. So overall, less rainfall from storms in A2 relative to historical. But over time, even the rain budget for the storms increases, and eventually it becomes greater than the historical. So that's something we're going to have to tunnel in further and look at. This is just an initial brush of looking at the Midwest, but I want to look at now the extreme events in these models and look at member by member. So I find that it's kind of unexpected. I didn't expect to see, you know, overall dry and then wetter at the end. I thought it would, quite frankly, be drier for the whole run. So and we'll also have to see if there's an outlier in terms of the simulations, but, you know, it might be that this is what the models are producing in terms of the warming scenario. And finally, I thought I'd just throw this in. So this is just touching what I mentioned before, the NSTEP runs, looking at teleconnections. So this is the partial correlation. Partial correlation is a method where you can just correlate two variables together and exclude other variables. So it gives you a kind of cleaner signal. So it's a correlation of winter storm track frequency. This is for the ECP2 mesoscale model driven by NSTEP. And I'm looking at wintertime, January to March. I correlated the storm frequency of each grid box with the EIS index. The EIS index is a proxy for NSTEP, and it's a running mean, and it's a bit more accurate than looking at NINA 3.4. And what you're seeing here, you're seeing all these positive correlations across the Gulf of Mexico, up across the southeast coast, and you're seeing these negative correlations across the Great Lakes. I haven't had time to assess significance, and also I want to do this in the ensemble sense. But this gives you a little bit of an appetizer here where you're seeing this implies an increase in storm mist due to El Nino in this particular model run, and a decrease in storms up across the Great Lakes and the Midwest. It's something, once again, we can explore by each season for all four runs. What are the conclusions so far? So NARCCAP data is definitely well-suited for storm track research. Frequency and intensity climatologists look realistic, filtering improved results markedly in the Rockies. Noted a polar shift in storm tracks in the cold half of the year. Some results are curious for their increase in storms. As I said, more explanation is needed. Gray reef cyclones are likely a culprit, since the intensity analysis doesn't support an increase in intensity of those particular storms. Also interesting, stronger storms can fall in the A2 simulation, another area that needs to be explored. Storm variance shows active storm track regions in North Pacific, Rockies, Northeast Coast, which is what you'd expect to look at, to look like rather. Linking storms to rainfall improved co-location of the rainfall with the storms. A fraction of rainfall attributed to storms, just showing a budget of water in the storms relative to the whole climatology, which well previous work. So I did a reanalysis, and 20 to 30% is about what I got also with the reanalysis data as well. For our project, drying develops in A2 in the southwest in JFM and spreads across much of the country by JAS, especially for total precipitation. Interesting, once again, for that Midwestern index, A2 starts drier, but ends up wetter by the 2060s, both for the total rainfall and the storm. This is really going to be a high priority for me to look at much more in detail. And a glance at NSTEP-driven run shows decent NSTEP response for storm frequency. And so I'll also be doing NSTEP studies with my four-model ensemble NSTEP runs, and also looking at other indices such as NAO, PNA, among others. So what's next then? So explore rainfall extremes. So I'm getting to the point now I can assess with the plant team I'm finally getting rainfall diagnostics. I examine individual members, so for the stronger storms in fall on A2. What I also want to do is, since I'm looking at 2038-2070, I want to look at the last 5 years of the run. So that's the most extreme. So I want to examine the last 5 years where the warming is maximized. I also want to incorporate other data to examine model physics, for example, looking, you know, if I want to look at rainfall in the Midwest, looking at the Louisville Jet, I can get the 850 winds, 925 winds. There's so many different variables I can get from the models. I'm now well-trained to get anything I want at this point pretty quickly. I also want to compare various model suites, so I have groups of models. For example, I have HRM3 versus ECB2 versus WARF model, and so I can look at all these different model suites and see if there's a difference in terms of how the different model suites perform. I'd also like to explore internal variability via the NSTEP runs. These are also important for agriculture. And also, notice I didn't show a difference for precipitation because the t-test is not going to work well. So I want to look at something, for example, a gamma distribution to look at the significance of rainfall data. And that's all I have for now, and that's what I did in my summer vacation. Thanks.
All right, thanks, Tim. In record time, too. Are there any questions for Tim?
Hey, Tim, this is Bo.
Go ahead, Bo.
Is there a difference between using NSEP, the NSEP product in the NARCCAP experiment, using that for exploring the effects of El Nino Southern Oscillation on North America versus using traditional reanalysis products like the North American Regional Reanalysis or MERA or...
Oh, it should be. I would think it's roughly comparable because they come from the same conditions. And so that's what I'm after. So I've already done, I got a whole bunch of results already established for a lot of the reanalysis data sets, all the way from reanalysis 1 all the way through CFS reanalysis. I've written several papers on that. So that's exactly where I'm going with this. I want to compare what this looks like relative to reanalysis, which would be, I guess, what you call pseudo ground truth.
Right, okay.
And by the way, I can't do that with the A2 and the struggle because that domain does not go down to equatorial Pacific. So I even looked, around for the GCMs. Maybe there was like some sort of SST so I can calculate some sort of Nino index, but I have not been able to find anything on that. So I'd love to be able to show that for the A2 especially, but I don't seem to have that available.
You can go track down GCM simulations.
I need to find out exactly if I can find the SST fields that drove those models. If I can do that, then I can look at all of them.
Okay.
I know it's not on the NARCCAP site.
This is Justin Wilkerson. I have a question. So right now you're running the forecast on half-degree grids. I was wondering if you'd be able at any point to get that to a higher resolution at all.
It might be a way to downscale or upscale, however you want to say it. So I'd say that's a possibility. I think that's also something discussed with the plants. I know a lot of the plant group wants something higher resolution. So I think that'd be an area of brainstorming to be done. So could I take my half degree rainfall data and downscale to, let's say, a quarter degree or even something even at higher resolution than that? So I would say I'll answer that as being possible. That's been done.
Right, yeah, because that's what I was thinking about. Because I did a quick look on Google Earth, and Missouri is 4 degrees in both north, south, and east, west. So you're only getting about 64 grid points on a half-degree grid, and the plant group might be a little upset at that.
Yeah, so that's something where we could actually see if we could actually downscale to a higher resolution.
All right.
Okay, Tim. Hey, but just to be clear, though, so the results that you're generating, though, are coming from model solutions that are not your own. Is that accurate? NARCCAP,
yeah.
I point this out only because of the words that Justin used. In terms of running the model, the running of the model is not that half degree output resolution is not something that's under your control. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay,
that
was
quite clear to me.
Yeah.
These are effectively the standard that's being used at the moment within the community.
Yeah, and if you go back even, let's say, 3 or 4 years ago, the standard at that point was like 2 by 2.5, which I couldn't even do anything with on the scale. Half degree, we could do a little bit.
With what Justin's saying, 0.5 is too coarse, but by the same token, that's what's available at the moment. I want to make sure I understand this.
Yes.
Okay.
That makes sense.
All right. I did have one question for you. When you were discussing the that? Why is that?
Well, yeah, well, that's what the 5x5 is. All the 5x5 is like the climatology. The rainfall takes the storm point. So, you know, a possibility, and I found it's kind of, you know, what's difficult about doing that analysis, and I agree, it's somewhat crude. I can go for, you know, it might be the fact that some of the rainfall is escaping because the storms are a larger scale. So it might be, for instance, that some of that rainfall data goes all the way down, let's say, another few more degrees of latitude south of where I'm looking. My worry also in doing this, though, is always that if I start going too far with it, I'll start to contaminate what I'm getting with other storms.
Right.
So, you know, I could look at that and by far up the percentages.
Size of the domain you've chosen.
Yes.
Okay. All right, anybody else? So, all right, thanks, Tim. Appreciate it.
My pleasure.
And before everybody jumps off here, I just, not everybody was on at the very beginning. We were waiting for some of the latecomers to show up. If you're a regular on the Climate Team call, or even if you're not, that's going to start on September 7th. That's a Wednesday at 10 a.m., and we're going to shoot for using the first Wednesday of every month at that same time. Going forward, at least for October and November and December, and possibly beyond if that still continues to fit everyone's schedule. So we will look forward to talking to everybody again on Wednesday, September 7th at 10. All right, well, thanks, everybody, and thanks, Tim.